Alright, so Descent 2. Yeah, he did beat it in 0 seconds. He's pretty good. Alright, so Descent 2, it's mostly more of the same. But, I mean, I'll explain it as we go. So... Alright, countdown. 3, 2, 1, go. So yeah, Descent 2, as you can see, mostly, you know, kind of the same idea. Originally, this was actually slated to just be an expansion pack for Descent 1, but then they got to the point where they're like, okay, we're adding too much. This is a new game entirely. So right off the bat, you know, we're gonna Death Warp. You guys already know how that works. Exactly the same here as it does in Descent 1. And the, you know, general premise is the same. Find reactor, blow it up, escape level. GG. Are a few new mechanics added, like switches. Like I just blew up that switch there to unlock that door. And also, this accessory I'm picking up here, the afterburner. Does about what you would expect. Gives you a nice boost of speed. Makes you a nice speedy boy. It does take up energy, though, so it does make this run a bit of a balancing act as far as energy is concerned. Because you have to make sure you are, you know, you want to use afterburner as much as possible, but you've not got to make sure you have enough energy for using your primary weapon. Because if you can't use your primary weapon, that's generally bad news bears. Speaking of energy consumption, I'm going to go out of my way right here. I'm going to quick save, actually, though, just in case this goes wrong. Going to do a little bit of, you know, secret hunting here. Whoa, the thief bot. Okay, he just stole my headlight. And we are going to complete this elaborate secret sequence to grab the Helix Cannon. The Helix Cannon is essentially an upgraded spread fire. It shoots 5 projectiles instead of 3, and it does insane damage, but it does consume a ton of energy, so you have to be really mindful of your energy usage. That's really going to come into play in the next level here. And this level introduces Diamond Claws. The variants in Descent 2 are a lot more threatening than they are in Descent 1. Not only do they have more evasive AI, which, by the way, everything in this game has more evasive upgraded AI compared to the first game, so they're a lot harder to fight in general, and they're better at hitting their shots. But not only do they have, are they kind of hard to hit sometimes because of the way they move somewhat randomly, but you saw a little bit back there. If you hit them with energy weapons, they counter with a homing plasma attack, which gives you this really obnoxious dilemma if they get in your face, where it's like, well, you know, I have to shoot him to get him off me, but there's a chance he's gonna just, you know, spew plasma all over my face, and that's no good. So yeah, Diamond Claws, very dangerous. We do our best to avoid or kill them whenever possible. And yeah, I'm really low on energy right now. Thankfully, I got a couple random drops right here. Let me think, what else do I have to explain about this? Oh yeah, the thief bot. I had some encounters with him and never explained him. He's in almost every level, and he does exactly what he says on the tin. He tries to steal items from you. Usually he just steals really, you know, insignificant things like a concussion missile or something, but sometimes he likes to steal your afterburner or your Earthshaker missiles, and it's a bad time when he does that. So we're coming up on the first boss level, and we don't actually really want to do most of this level, so we're going to sequence break it. Sequence breaking is really not something that's in the first game. The first game's pretty, just, you know, straightforward, raw execution, not much you can do to skip content. But this, in Descent 2, we've introduced guided missiles, and with guided missiles, if we don't mess up, we can hit switches we aren't intended to. Like so. So that's gonna let me get into the arena early, and just fight the boss right away without doing any key collection. Ooh. Oh yeah, something else that got introduced in this game, flash missiles. For better or for worse, they're in the game. So, first boss, we're just gonna kinda try and circle strafe around him and, burst him down. He'll go down pretty quickly because, excuse me. I'm not really intended to have the Helix Cannon this early in the game. Did he not die? I thought he died. I guess that was someone else's explosion I was seeing. Well, so entering the secret level is a little premature. But yeah, secret level portals. Okay. I did save right before the fight, so. Little premature celebration, perhaps. I thought he was dead. I guess he probably spawned something and it died immediately, and that's the explosions I was seeing. Okay, there we go. He's dead for real this time. So yeah, we can't reach the normal exit, so we're gonna use this secret level portal. Because thankfully you can use secret level portals as exits as well. And with that, we're on to World 2, Quartzon, which is the water world. Water's a new thing introduced in this game, but it doesn't really do much. It does, kind of shake your ship a bit if you run into it. Nullifies splash damage if missiles and such hit the water, so generally it's pretty safe. So you'll know that I was really cautious about grabbing that Luigi, and that's because there's a trigger on it, which, raises some walls on the return trip, but if you just barely touch that key, then the walls don't raise, and you're good to go. So bad luck there, I did not get the random cloak drop I can potentially get there, so I'm gonna have to be able to do this part of the level uncloaked, which is a little annoying, but this level's generally not too bad. So grabbed a new weapon back there, which is the Gauss Cannon. The Gauss Cannon is essentially this game's upgraded version of the Vulcan Cannon. It shoots explosive, you know, very fast-moving invisible projectiles, which is really nice because, it uses Vulcan ammo instead of energy, so it doesn't trigger the counterattack from Diamond Claws. Two, it's really good for sniping enemies out because of that. And, you know, like in Descent 1, it's also good for opening doors from a distance. And three, primary weapon not spending energy means more energy for afterburning. So, there you go. So these are pretty much the weapons you're going to see for most of the rest of the run. The fusion cannon, while it was really overpowered in the first game, got nerfed into absolute oblivion in this game. The damage it does is pretty laughable, so it's not worth mentioning at all. There is a backup strat using the fusion cannon if I get my quad lasers stolen at a really inconvenient time, because the quad lasers are involved in a key glitch later on in the run. But I'll cover that when I get to it. Those diamond claws are really annoying. If you don't get down that hallway before the cloak runs out, then they tend to... When did they last save? I think there's an afterburner in the hallway up ahead. That thief bot just stole my afterburner, so that's really bad for a speedrun. Like, if this were a world record attempt, that's a dead run right there. The thief bot flees from you really quickly and has a ton of health, so it's not worth trying to get it back. He also stole my quad lasers, which is really fun. Okay, yeah, there's an afterburner right there, so we're good. Oh yeah, the thief bot generally has a pretty predictable route, but sometimes he likes to surprise you. And whenever he surprises you, it's never good. So yeah, I was too busy trying to remember if there was an afterburner here to really explain that. We just sequence broke, I guess. there's a secret switch at the bottom of that grate, and shooting it opens a secret passage that lets you skip the blue and yellow keys, so this level's pretty short because of that. Cannon, as always, continues to absolutely destroy reactors. Really short periods of time. And we're on to the boss level for Quartzon, and this level is exactly the same story as the last. Secret switch right there, go straight to Red Key. So this level's pretty short as well. Got a trigger skip here, hopefully I get it. I think that was good, not sure. No, I must have gotten Must have tripped it when I got knocked around with that Mercury missile back there. So I gotta go on my way and hit the switch. So this boss is pretty easy because I grab a cloaking device right there, so he's gonna try to hit me without much success. Ooh, he teleported. That's rare. There we go. There he is. Okay, he is dead. Alright, so now we are on to Brimspark, which is the lava world, and as you probably could guess, it's one of the hardest worlds in the game, because lava's, you know, dangerous. Descent 2 also adds lava falls, which sometimes you have to go through them to progress, and while you're flying through them, you do take damage. You can actually get stuck in really bad situations where, like, you're behind a lava fall and you have no shields, and you just have to die to the lava fall. It's pretty crappy. So, yeah, there's a bit of RNG with respect to cloaking device drops in this level. I got really lucky and got both of them, which is almost unheard of, honestly. So that's gonna make this level pretty straightforward. You're gonna see me use some smart mines this level. Smart mines are this game's upgraded version of the proximity bombs. Not only do they explode on contact, but they also send out a bunch of homing energy that locks onto nearby enemies. So they're really strong, very useful in a lot of situations. Almost forgot about the second cloak drop. Thankfully, I just happened to fly over it. So with that cloak, we're going to have a pretty easy time. So reactor room.
Self-destruct sequence activated.
Wow, that's really bad luck. Cloaked Diamond Claw just happened to wander right into the path towards the exit. Alright, so now we're on Lava Falls Extraction Center, which I consider one of the hardest levels in the run. There's a lot of nasty stuff going on in this level. This level also introduces E-Bandits, which when they touch you, they, you know, as you might guess, they drain your energy. So yeah, grabbing this key is really dangerous. There's lots of enemies in the area. Just kind of rush past them and hope they don't really give you too much trouble. There's the fusion cannon. Again, I don't plan on using it. Although I do need to remember to grab the extra quad lasers, because I did lose them earlier on the run. So, this level, all of the keys are held by bots. This is the only one that's out in the open, though, and I have a cloaking device, which just lets me snipe him out without activating him. Makes it a lot easier. Okay, so yeah, I just kind of want to carry this invulnerability as far as it'll take me. Just power past everything. Go for a bit of safety here, see if I'm gonna cloak drop up here. Yes, I did. That makes this segment a lot safer. I say as I almost die. Way to go me. Take this. Whoa, I bumped something. Get out of there. Okay, so I'm pretty low on shields, but, and I do have to make the extra side trip to pick up the quad lasers. The quad lasers are essential for the next level, believe it or not, despite the fact that I'm not really using lasers at all for combat. And I will explain that in a bit when I get to it. I have to be really careful with these mine layers, because they like to crash into you and do tons of damage. Like that. Thankfully, there's a bunch of extra shield pickups right here, so this nightmare of a level is pretty much over now. A little bit rocky, but at least I didn't die. So, yeah, silver linings. So anyway, as I was talking about, the quad lasers are really important, and the reason for that is that there's a bug associated with the extra two projectiles added. They actually spawn slightly ahead of your ship, and you can shoot through walls like that. So the switch to unlock that door right there is immediately opposite of it, and you can just shoot through it and unlock the door early. Skips the need to go with the blue key, saves a lot of time. That's actually a bug that's present in Descent 1 as well, but it just has no application. Mainly because, you know, switches weren't a thing in Descent 1. Yeah, kill this guy. Okay. Take the time to kill that seeker and try and pick up traps from him, because mercury missiles are pretty valuable. Don't think I've ever explained mercury missiles. Mercury missiles are a new weapon to Descent 2. They're an extremely fast-moving, highly damaging dumbfire missile, so they're pretty useful. Bandit drained all my energy. Thankfully, you bandits have a high chance to drop lots of energy, so the fact that I just lost all my energy there is no big deal, because he dropped a bunch. So anyway, we're coming up on the boss level for Broomspark, Manticore Station, and it does need some explanation. Because it is a level where we want a Death Warp, but, you know, as you probably guessed, I don't really want to give up this gear, so... As usual, we're going to be suiciding right at the start, just to store my items, where I can pick them up again later. But, it comes with a condition on this level, because this is the largest... most populated level of the game. And you can see I'm spraying all sorts of items, all sorts of garbage there. Tons of stuff there, and that actually has an effect on the poor game, because it can only handle there being so many things in the level at once. So you're gonna notice both me and enemies are gonna sometimes have problems spawning attacks. You'll just keep seeing projectiles randomly despawning or failing to spawn altogether. Which is, you know, both a blessing and a curse. Mostly a curse, because melee enemies like that diamond claw right there don't care about not being able to spawn, you know, projectiles. And if I get pinned by one of those, there's a good chance I'm not going to be able to do anything about it, because I'm probably going to have problems attacking them back. So, I need to be really careful around enemies like that, especially. Okay, there's a narrow choke point here I need to get through before he bandits block me. And I did it. Thankfully, I picked up a mega missile earlier, so as long as it spawns, which it did, I can kill myself very quickly and warp back to the start. But we're not picking up our gear yet, because we still got a red key to grab. See, this is the problem, though. Okay, was able to squeeze past him, good. So yeah, lots of diamond claws and e-bandits in this area, which I'll have to manipulate to get around. Just provoke them into rushing in, and... Yeah, I'll do a quick loop around him. The E-Bandit there is in an unusual spot. He actually went through the door. That's really unusual. But here is the red key. And we're ready to fight the boss. Now, this boss is pretty dangerous. He shoots mega missiles, which, That was weird. Went to quick save and it kind of locked up for a bit. Which, you know, Mega Missiles are dangerous and very highly damaging, as I've mentioned before, so hopefully I can just stay outside of his range and gradually whittle him down, and he won't do anything. Because if you're beyond a certain range of enemies, they won't retaliate. So the hope is that he will just stay at a long range. Which, so far, he's been pretty cooperative in that sense. And he's dead. So that was really lucky. Got a couple of pistols. Alright, so we are on to Lime Frost Spiral, which is the ice world. And right off the bat, we've got one more quad laser. I have a really hard time hitting that one for some reason. And that's gonna just dump me right into the reactor room. So, shortest level in the game. So, yeah, as the ice level, there are terrible ice physics everywhere. Except not, because, you know, we were flying. That wouldn't make any sense. So, ice level actually just means it's a blue and white color palette and nothing else. And more importantly, it means no lava whatsoever. Thank the Lord. So this level, it's pretty straightforward. Gonna be using that cloaking device to, avoid combat for the most part. Shield, so I'm going to drop a quick save here just to be on the safe side. Alright, and this level, like we saw earlier in the run, I'm going to use a secret level portal as the exit. Not because I can't reach the normal exit, but because it's just closer. So right off here, right off the bat here, we're going to suicide again, because we want to store our items for later. For later death warp. So we are going to be running some pretty minimal gear here for a little while. Thankfully, there are some pickups along the way to help make this a little less painful. In fact, right here, we're going to grab an afterburner. Whoa, that Lugard is really out of his usual position. And we're going to grab our good old friend, the Blueberry Launcher, the old Spread Fire Cannon. Which, you know, for the most part in this game has been totally obsoleted by the Helix Cannon. But he gets a little bit of time in the sun right here. Welcome back, Blueberry Launcher. Ooh, that is rough. I think I have to just redo that because I'm going to pick up a lot of items again. Okay. Well. Sometimes things like this happen, especially when you're on minimal gear like this, damage can be a little hard to avoid sometimes, and I took some really unfortunate damage from the Seeker by the way, so. If you guys liked that segment, you get to see him again! Okay, doing much better on shield this time, so we should be fine. Okay, so we got a little bit of RNG coming up here. There is a chance for a replacement cloaking device coming up here. This guy right here can drop one. And we got one, so that's nice, gonna make things a little easier. And you can say goodbye to the spread fire cannon, because we'll get a Gauss cannon right there to do the rest of this key run. Whoa, that almost killed me. Oh, that's fine, though, because I need to die right here anyway. So there we go. Now we have all the keys, and we can just grab all the items here. Which also conveniently includes an invulnerability power-up in that secret little room there. So, at this point, we can just rush through the rest of the level. Alright, so we are on the boss level for Lime Frost Spiral now, Terra Frost Catacombs. This is a boss that would be pretty tough to fight in a, in a head-on confrontation. So thankfully, we're going to be dirty cowards and use cloaking devices. And this level has no shortage of cloaking devices. That was a good bit of RNG there, getting that cloaking drop there. Let's see if we can get one here. Yep, got another one there too for later. Worth noting that the way Cloak and Invulnerability works, you cannot pick up a new one if you currently have one active. So I will be saving that for later. You can't pick it up and have it, you know, have its length extended to your current one or anything like that. Doesn't work like that, unfortunately. So, interesting thing about this level is it actually does have another intended, like, little secret sequence break you can do using a guided missile. And unlike the one in level 4, it's 100% intended. Gives you a lot of extra power-ups and stuff, but it takes a little while to set up and actually doesn't save any time to do that sequence break, so... I'm just gonna skip over that secret and do the level pretty much as intended. We're doing really good on shields, though, and there is an invulnerability by the red key coming up. And as long as I can reach that, I should be fine. Go, got the vulnerability, so the rest of this level should be pretty smooth sailing. This boss is immune to energy weapons, so I can't burst him down super fast with the Helix Cannon, even as much as I would like to. The last boss was actually like that too, and I kind of neglected to mention that, which is, you know, part of the reason why the sniping strategy against the Magna Core Station boss is a thing. Because you can't hit him with Helix anyway. But, yeah, this boss shoots really fast-moving homing projectiles. Can also flash you. Do all sorts of nasty things to you. But we're just gonna be cloaked and kind of do our little circle strafe dance here. Guys can't see much, but I'm killing him, trust me. There we go. And he's dead. Alright, and we're on to the second to last one in the game. Right off the bat, we start with a really annoying level. This level starts with a Keybot, and he's in a pretty open area. So hopefully I get him quickly. Good. Yeah, that is like just barely within his aggro range, so when you start shooting at him, he has a chance to just run away. And those Keybots move way faster than you can possibly move, even with tricording and... tricording and afterburning, they will outspeed you, so they're a huge pain in the butt to chase down. It's pretty much down to luck if you can chase them down once they get away from you. Pretty bad start to this level, pretty darn low on shields. I'm going to be going out of my way for some extra pickups. Got some good energy drops there. Ooh, nice. So this level is a bit interesting. The red key, the red door here, blocks from the inside, but there is a bug we can exploit to prevent that from happening if we just put a map marker down right there. Map markers have no collision, for all intents and purposes, except with doors, for whatever reason. They keep doors from closing. So, we're gonna keep the door open that way, and avoid having to go through a much more dangerous path, that takes you directly through a mat set. He fought, stole a bunch of stuff, but, one of the things he stole was my quad lasers, but I am done with the quad laser bugs, so I don't need those anymore. I don't really need anything he stole, so I don't really mind. So this whole world, it's kind of built around having these huge, like, sprawling maze-like, layouts, which makes them pretty fast for speedrunning, because, as long as you know where you're going, it's, yeah, not all too bad. Lots of extra shield drops, which is really nice. When you're speedrunning and you're just leaving a lot of enemies alive, you can lose shields so quickly. So it's always good to have a little extra safety. Whoa, what is bumping me? There's a cloaked enemy there. That's what's bumping me. So this door's locked from the other side, so I need to unlock it from this side and then fly around. So we're gonna grab what is considered the most powerful primary and secondary weapons right there, the Omega Cannon and the Earthshaker Missile. The Omega Cannon is actually completely useless, so you're not gonna see it at all. It shoots, like, can shoot short bursts of, like, booming lightning sort of stuff. It's really good for tracking faster enemies, picking them out quickly, but, for here, in the speedrunning context, it's far from the optimal DPS, so it's not worth using. And that reward still goes to the Helix Cannon. Yeah. So this room is filled with cloaked smelters. They're really annoying. Also, diamond claws that like to just push you around. Kind of overused energy bit, so I'm out. I'm gonna have to use my last finish off the reactor. That's okay. And this level is like really goes heavy on that that kind of mazy aspect I was talking about earlier. There's all sorts of red herrings in this level. So in a speedrun, this level is not all that bad. It's pretty quick when you know where you're going, and also the enemy composition is generally pretty non-threatening. Putting a little damage on those enemies, because I will need to go through that passage later. Alright, so, yeah, already almost done with this level here. And then we'll be on to the boss level, which is called Get Out Station. It's kind of a bit of a joke about the name is kind of a bit of a joke about the exit sequence for the level, which is excruciatingly long. The path to the exit door is very, very distant and takes a lot of time to get through. There's lots of enemies in the way, so we're not going to use it. There's the secret level portal in the boss arena. We're just going to use that instead. This is also, incidentally, it is the last level where the thief bot should have a chance to steal stuff from me. I was really lucky, though, and got an early cloak drop. That cloak drop does not happen very often. But when it does happen, it's really nice. It smooths out this level significantly. Force field to get the key here, and then, ooh, random mine. That's unfortunate. So So hopefully I get a cloaking drop. Okay, there we go. Nice. So I'm going to have a cloaking device for the boss, which is, you know... Oh, okay, there's another one. That's actually unfortunate, because I picked that up earlier than intended. But this boss does have a plasma counterattack, so having the cloaking device is nice. Does mean I don't have to worry about it so much. This boss is actually immune to Gauss as well, so I'm forced to use the most damaging weapon in my arsenal to kill him. Which, you know, can't say I'm all that upset about. And just hit that switch to open up the secret level, and there we go. So just a quick fly through the secret level, and then we're on to the last world, the Omega system. Start of this level, we've got one last guided missile sequence break. Also, one last opportunity for the thief bot to screw me over, because he can block my missile here. He didn't, I just accidentally hit the spider instead. There we go, got it. So that's going to let me skip the blue key. So, as you might guess, being the last world, the most dangerous enemy types get introduced here. Actually taking extra care there to kill said dangerous enemies there. Boar's heads, they shoot smart missiles. Ah. So yeah, this level's also got a keybot for the red key, which is really annoying. I try to snipe him out from a distance, but sometimes he gets away from me. Want to try to avoid hitting that switch, because that switch is going to open up the thief bot. There we go. Got the key, so we're good to go. And most of the difficult parts of this level are pretty much over with now. So yeah, it also introduces these spider enemies. They work a lot like, the spiders from the first game, except they shoot concussion missiles, so obviously they have a little bit higher damage output, and they spawn, I believe they're called hornets, or I think they're, no, they're called hornets of the red ones. The green ones are just called spawns, which are a little more dangerous because they shoot level 4 lasers, but they're also really hard to hit, which is the more annoying part of them. So we got one last death warp sequence here. This yellow door is right by the start. The yellow key is quite a bit away, so we're just gonna deposit our gear right there. I'm gonna use smart mines to take out the boar's head right here. Whoa. Mines, when you lay them, do carry a little bit of the player's momentum, so you can use that to just kind of nudge them around corners like that, and then shoot them to activate the homing yeah, the homing globs. That's really unfortunate, RNG. Hate being stuck killing that guy with basic lasers, but I don't. Elky's right here. I'm just gonna suicide. Report back at the start. Grab the red key and be on our way. So, I'm going to take a bit of a safety grab here. I'm actually going to go this way and grab a cloaking device just to make this last part a bit safer. There's a bit of a tricky trick with this reactor room. It's another door where it locks from the inside, and you can kill the reactor before the door shuts again if you're really quick about it, so let's hopefully do it. Got it. That's really great. If you've missed that, then you're forced to do a little bit of flying around in there to unlock the door again. But we're on to the second to last level, so... this level is called I Wimmel, which is supposedly an acronym for I Wish I Had More Lights, which is a reference to the fact that there are absolutely no energy pickups in this level whatsoever. It's a really small level, but... yeah, the lack of energy pickups does make it a pretty tricky one, so I'm going to be using Gauss the entire way until the end so I can save my energy for helixing the end reactor. I think I just saved right before that, so. That room is really tough. It's really easy to get caught in there with homing missiles on your tail. There we go. That's better. So yeah, saving my energy for afterburning and helixing the reactor. Ooh. I did just save again there, and now I didn't. I probably should have just taken that death and reclaimed my gear. It's whatever. Yeah, this level is pretty pretty tough. Okay. We're just gonna take this room a little more slowly, just so that we don't get nailed again. There we go. Okay. Should be fine at this point. Gonna grab extra shields down here. And there's a guaranteed invulnerability drop coming up. So once again, you know, shout out to Sega Saturn. That's gonna make the rest of this level really easy. Bit of a weird kind of door puzzle here. Just gotta fly into all these nooks to trigger the next doors. And we're on to the last level. There's a big dramatic cutscene that tries to make it look like this huge imposing thing, but it's actually one of the shorter levels in the game. And it's made easier by the fact that this Lugar guaranteed drops an invulnerability. And all the keys are pretty much gathered up in one side of the level, so pretty easy to ride this invulnerability through all the key collection. And vulnerability is absolutely necessary for that room, by the way. There are four spiders right there shooting me as I try to grab the blue key, so. Without the invulnerability, I would be dead in half a second. So, this last boss, it's a bit unique. Instead of having a particular weapon immunity, he's immune to attacks from his front. You have to hit him from behind. But there's an invulnerability in his arena, which makes him easier. Of course, he will be trying to keep his back away from you, which makes it a little tricky, especially with the explosion graphics covering up, blocking your view, but that's a pretty good kill. So time's in, like, 3 seconds as soon as I hit the exit, and time.
Readings I'm getting considering on this I had some pretty bad consistent with any of the others I've destroyed. Fun, so. It's actually moving.
I'm totally fine with that.
Maintaining speed and heading just like a starship. Now, whatever this thing is, it's getting ready to blow itself to pieces. Good.
Listen to that gruff, edgy mercenary dude.
No more, I'm done. All that's left is to go home, get my money, and sleep for the next 2 years.
Valhalla Tower, this is Vertigo 1. I'm starting the jump pre-sequence and returning home.
Acknowledged, Materia Defender. Hurry home.
So yeah, that's Descent business. And Descent 2. I hope you all enjoyed. There's a bit of a cliffhanger cutscene ending here for Descent 3.
Malfunction?
We don't talk about Descent 3.
This isn't happening.
Valhalla, warp drive is malfunctioning. Repeat, warp drive is malfunctioning.
That's all I really have to say about that.
Jump, repeat, abort, jump. I can't.
Yeah, bit of a shameless self plug. I will be running this at AGDQ. I'd also like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to get some marathon practice. It's definitely very much appreciated.
Material defender! Material defender!
Honestly, Descent 3 wasn't that bad. Well, it's a pretty horrible speedrun, I can tell you that much. Honestly, though, I'm most proud of myself. I did not break out into a huge whipping cough at any point in the run. Like, maybe a couple coughs here and there, but glad I was able to at least give pretty consistent commentary without, you know, sounding like Death Incarnate. So, got the high score again. We'll just stick with the Dragon Tree lock and loaded. There we go. 3905 in-game. So, sub 40 in-game time, but I mean, that doesn't count lives. So. Take that as you will. But, yeah, so. That's all I've got. Thanks for watching, y'all.